Okay, I'm recording now. So, if you guys can you give me some questions to answer? But if you don't have any questions on your mind, just let me know so that we don't wait too long. And if you guys don't have any questions, I'll just start sharing things that come to my mind, of things that I feel are important for you all to know. Yeah, so any questions you guys have about these things or the scrolls? No questions right now? Okay. What about the other David? Okay, so we've got an interesting question on the issue of this is the question asked by Kay. And she says, "Oh, David, you have the two on, okay." Okay. So Kay asks, "Did the Essenes think the Earth was flat?" So, before I answer that question, just to kind of help people who are listening understand, is that there are, within the movement of believers of the Bible, there is the discussion of whether or not, like, what the shape of the earth is. Is it spherical? Is it flat? And the answer to that question has a lot of ramifications on science and how we approach knowledge and what the experts are telling us. And so it's difficult to answer the question because in regards to the issue of the Earth being flat, because in regards to what did the Essenes believe, because there's not as much information in the scrolls that talk about that, but there is an apocrypha writing attributed to, which I believe I accept as authentic. It is what Jackson refers to as the Nazarene Acts of the Apostles. I don't consider it the Nazarene Acts of the Apostles, but I consider it the recordings of the Apostle Peter's teachings by his disciple Clement. And in these recordings, they have debates with certain non-believers. And in the debates, it basically they present the different possibilities, and they say some Greek philosophers say that the Earth is a sphere, and they describe how it's in all directions, it's equal as a sphere. And they said if the shape of the Earth is like this, that shows that God's providence, you know, it shows his intelligence, you know, kind of like the intelligent design type of thing. It's an amazing testimony to his creative ability. But then he said, on the other hand, there's the other interpretation people have, the other viewpoint, and that is of the Earth is kind of floating in water viewpoint, which seems to me to be talking about the flat Earth concept. But in that writing, they never say, this is the correct position. So it's kind of interesting because it leaves it up to us to figure out what it is. But it makes it seem like, believers, the way the Apostle Peter and his disciples discuss that issue, they present it almost in a way that's like, whichever you believe, it's not so important in regards to like, dividing away from people. Like, you know, there's a lot of people who like to separate from others or unfriend people even, or, you know, to not talk to them anymore over very small issues like this. And it seems to me that while it is an important issue, it's not so important. Because in either case, like, let's say, like, currently I'll tell you that I believe in the spherical model. But I would say that if the flat Earth model is correct, that doesn't change so much for me. It pretty much the same belief, same faith I have is the same, the religion. It just means that how people are interpreting it is not quite what's actually happening, but the same things are happening. Everything we're seeing happening, that's happening. It's just happening in a different way than we think it is, but it's all happening the same. So I, for myself, let me just share a little bit. It's not, it's related to the question, but it kind of branches off into other things, and that is, I do believe that there can be conspiracy theories, but I am very skeptical of the existence of conspiracy theories. So in my mind, I feel like we should by default reject conspiracy theories, and only if people can absolutely prove that there was a conspiracy and that people are lying or, you know, falsifying things, then we are to reject, you know, the current viewpoint and believe that there is a conspiracy. But so, for example, I don't believe in I believe in geocentrism as opposed to heliocentrism. The scientists currently teach that the heliocentrism, which is the Earth is on an axis and it's rotating every day and it's revolving around the sun all constantly. So we're traveling thousands of miles per hour according to the scientist. I reject that. I think that's bogus. I don't think there's enough science to support that. And I don't think the scriptures support it, which is the most important thing, because science is so easily twistable by people. People think science proves something, and it does if you actually have the true proof of scripture. But if you don't, you might think science proves it, but it really doesn't. And so when science is not 100% certain on something, I always side with what the scripture has to say, based on my understanding of what the scriptures say. And it seems clear to me that the scriptures are teaching a geocentric model where the Earth is completely stationary. It's not on an axis, so there's no axis. There's no tilt. It's completely straight. It's the sun's angle which has the axis, the angle, and it's constantly changing. That's the geocentrism model, where the sun, moon, and stars go around the Earth every day. So I don't agree with the scientists on so many things. So don't get me wrong with, you know, I'm not saying we should just accept what the scientists are saying, but I can accept geocentrism as true without saying that there's a conspiracy. I don't have to say there's a conspiracy, because there's enough, like, the way they come to the conclusions of heliocentrism isn't conspiratorial, rather it is a misinterpretation of what they are observing. So many false science things are not a conspiracy, but it is them being ignorant and being foolish in how they're doing the science. That's the same thing with evolution. Evolutionary science. So much of that science is speculation, which is accepted as proof, assumptions, you know, and so in regards to the flat Earth issue, I feel like the only way for the flat Earth issue to be true is if there's a grand conspiracy. And that's a problem for me. I have an issue with that. I'm open to the possibility, but I find it highly unlikely. So that's for me why I have a default position of not believing a conspiracy and believing that people are sincere and truly believe what they are saying. But as I said, there are conspiracies sometimes, so we have to be open to that possibility, but I'm going to be a skeptic until I see absolute evidence, because the Torah and the scriptures say we need to be careful how we're judging, because we will be held accountable for how we judge. If we are false judges, we are going to be responsible for that on Judgment Day, of how we judge other people. if we're condemning other people as being liars and they're not lying, you know, we're false witnesses, or, you know, accusing people who are innocent, and that's not good. So hopefully that answers the question sufficiently. Let's see. Okay, so are there any other questions on your guys' mind? But if there's not, then, you know, as I said, I'll just start. I will talk about whatever comes to my mind. But I would hope, you know, people have questions that I can answer in the way that I was hoping this would work out. But, you know, we don't have a lot of people, so it's okay if you guys don't have that really any questions, but if you do, please share. I'll wait a little bit to see if anyone has anything to say. And thank you all for coming. I appreciate the attendance, because when we don't have a lot of people, sometimes it's a little discouraging, but it really helps to have the support. And I know there are people who are going to be watching these who can't make it, so I do know there are people supporting. Yes. Okay, so there's the question of the constellations, and I'm assuming the question is, is there something important about constellations in the scriptures? I assume that's the question. And basically, the scriptures do mention constellations. Like, you know, we've got in the book of Job, there's the constellations, and Enoch talks a little bit about it. But it seems to me that the stars and the constellations are not so important. They're not on the same level as the sun and the moon. Because when Enoch, he gives calendar laws, and those laws that he gives the year according to the sun. He gives the year according to the sun, and he also gives the year according to the moon. But he never gives the year according to the stars or the constellations. So it seems to me that if the constellations or the stars have any purpose, it is to back up the other two calendars, to support them, but not to be a separate calendar. And it seems to me that the stars are not so much important in terms of following the correct calendar. Rather, the stars are there as a testimony to us, to help us find the correct calendar. But it is not the absolute guide to follow. And something to point out is that the scriptures, in the scriptures, it prophesies of in the future. This has not happened yet. It's going to happen. Well, basically, according to the book of Enoch, stars are alive, just like you and me. They are alive. They're spiritual beings. They are like animals in a sense. They are given commandments, they're given a law to obey the commands. And the commands are, the stars are given many different commands, but the main commands that are relevant to us that they are given is, here's the orbit that you are supposed to follow every year. Follow this order as you are told to do. So they go in the order that the angels tell them to follow. They see what the angels are telling them to do, and they follow that order. The scriptures prophesy of a great apostasy that's going to happen in the stars, basically in the end times, just like, as you know, in our time, the scriptures prophesied of humans, there being a great apostasy amongst humans in the last days, and that has already happened, and it's going to get even worse. But there's going to be a small revival, perhaps, of the true believers. But so, similarly, there is a there is an apostasy of the stars, prophesied to happen. It hasn't happened yet. It once happened partially by some of the stars falling away and going on false orders, but that was fixed and corrected. And the stars that did that were punished for it, according to the Book of Enoch. And so, basically, in the future, stars are going to disobey the law that was given to them, and they are going to violate the orders prescribed to them. And this is, I truly, with all my heart, believe that this is going to happen. In the future, it may not be in our lifetimes, okay? It might be in your kids or your grandchildren's lifetime. They're going to see the stars, like, you know, where they're supposed to be, and then all of a sudden they're going to start acting crazy like animals. The stars are going to move around, like, wherever they want to go, and people are going to freak out because this is completely insane what they're doing. This is not, you know, it just doesn't make sense what we're seeing in the sky. That's what's going to happen, I believe, according to what the scriptures say. The Book of Enoch makes that clear. And so, it's going to be some freaky stuff. The moon, the sun is going to speed up. The moon is going to lose its light. The sun is going to change in its light. It's going to be freaky stuff. So, since the stars are going to completely be unreliable in the future, I would say that's a good indication that the stars are not something we need to know to follow the correct calendar. It's only there as a help to us. It can help us. They're there for signs. So they teach us signs of seasons, but they're not as reliable as the sun and the moon. And according to the scriptures, although the sun is going to start going crazy and go much quicker, the year is going to be much shorter than it is currently. It's still going to be 364 days, but it's going to be a shorter day. Instead of 24 hours, it's going to be much shorter. It might be more like 16 hours, 12 hours, you know, it's going to be much shorter. And so the sun is going to stay the same in regards to the laws of the calendar. It's going to obey those rules forever until the end of the current time we are in, until the Messiah comes. The sun's always going to stay the same. So we can rely and trust the sun. That's the only one we can trust on. The moon is the second one we can trust, but that one's not as reliable. And the moon's going to do some strange things in the future. But the sun, we need to rely on the sun, because in the final days, it's going to start being crazy. And you know, imagine how the calendar is going to be when everyone is, you know, when the sun, stars, and moon are going all crazy. People are going to be like, we can't do the calendar. It's impossible to keep the calendar. But I believe it's not impossible when that happens. Rather, we have to keep Enoch's calendar 364 days, even when the days are super quick. And so, hopefully that answers about the stars. I think they're important, but not necessary to keep the calendar properly. And there's the question of the priestly order. Does it have anything to do with the calendar? Basically, the Dead Sea Scrolls, we find fragments of the calendar texts, and it seems to me that these were written by David and Solomon, because in the Old Testament, we're told that David and Solomon wrote a priest order, a priestly roster, for the Levites of how to serve, and that fits exactly what we're seeing in the scrolls of the calendar texts. The calendar documents give us the order of the priests, and how it goes along with the calendar. It's a very difficult to understand. I haven't fully figured it out, but the priests have to be much more focusing on all the calendar aspects than the regular people do. They have to know, like, they have to master the moon, the year of the moon. They have to master the year of the sun. They have to get it all together, synchronized and everything. Whereas for the regular people, the main thing we need to know is the sun. That's the main thing we need to know. And the other stuff is a little bit more complicated, which we should try to learn if we can, but it's so much is difficult to understand in these numbers that I say that for most people, what will be sufficient is if you just follow Enoch. The priest's role is to confirm the correct calendar by doing all that math. They make, you know, they confirm that it's correct and that we're doing it properly, and they use it to determine when the new priestly cycle comes. They use the calendars. And Lee, you asked a question that I'm not quite sure I understand the one question. If you can try to ask it again. The question is, you said, why does it line up 2013 to 2019 in the 294 cycle? Can you re-ask that question, but with slightly more detail of understanding? And let's see, the question was asked by Lee, when does Aviv 1 start according to the priestly order in the Dead Sea Scrolls? I don't have the exact scroll on hand at the moment, but I can tell you I've studied it, so I know this for a fact, that the scrolls specifically say that the Aviv 1 starts on the fourth day of the week. And it starts, so you've got Aviv 1 on a fourth day, and then there's the fifth day, which is day 2 of the month, sixth day is day 3 of the month, and the Sabbath is day 4 of the month. According to the priestly documents and the Dead Sea Scrolls in general, all the documents there that were found tell us that Aviv 4 is always a Sabbath. Aviv 4 is always a Sabbath. So Aviv 1 is always the fourth day of the week, according to the Dead Sea Scroll documents. So we really need to look to what the scrolls say to figure out the correct calendar, because I'm telling you, there's stuff in there that people are not following, but if we did, that would prove what the correct calendar is. It's amazing because we have King David's songs he did for the Sabbath sacrifice, and those tell us the dates of the Sabbath on the months for every year. So we just gotta follow King David, what he told us, and Enoch and Jubilees are clear that that the year is 364 days. So we gotta follow 364, not 365, like people are telling us. Some people are telling an Enoch calendar of 365 days, but we gotta ignore that. Follow what the scriptures are saying, 364 days. The priestly order, you know, they did the calendar best. They knew the calendar best. So we should take into consideration what the Essenes are saying. Why would we think we know better than the Essenes when, you know, we have so much missing that they did not have? They had so much more. So I think unless we're like complete experts at the math stuff, then we should be assuming by default that the scroll writers are correct, and that we are, if our math is not lining up with theirs, that we're misunderstanding, because they were so much smarter than us, in my view anyway. Now, let me see here. Okay, I haven't really worked out the moon yet, like how the lunar year works and stuff, in regards to the sun. Like, I'm very confident in my understanding of the correct keeping of the solar year. For the moon, however, I haven't fully studied nearly as close as I have the sun's cycle. So I'm a little bit unclear as to the proper cycles of the moon in relation to the sun. So I'm not quite sure, like when you talk about the moons lining up, that's very possible they are, and if they are, I'm sure that's significant in some way of helping us know what year we're in, helping us to figure out what the correct time we are in is. But other than that, I can't give too much more about what you were asking because I'm not very confident in my understanding of the lunar year right now. Let's see. Yeah, what I do know is that that Enoch tells us that the moon's cycle alternates between 29 days and 30 days, and that on rare occasions it's 28 days. And that Enoch tells us that there are three cycles where we are to use to synchronize the two calendars, and they are every 3 years, every 5 years, and every 8 years. And we do see every 3, 5, and 8 years, on average, where we see a synchronization time. And so that may be a key way of figuring out, like helping to figure out why the moons are lining up or when they line up. And the moons are for science, but they, you know, as Jubilee says, it's the sun that's for the holy times. And Genesis, for instance, tells us that the sun and moon are for times and seasons. Well, if the sun and moon are, which one are we to use more than the other? Which one? The sun or the moon? People who follow the lunar calendar they're saying, oh, we're going to use the moon as our main determination. But according to the scriptures, like, you know, Enoch and all the others, so many others, it tells us that the sun actually is the primary one, and the moon is the secondary. It has a purpose. It is to be used to help figure out the proper times. But since it's secondary, if you don't understand the moon's cycle, it may not be so bad, so long as you understand very well the sun's cycle. That's what I would say for that. Now, for some reason, this medium we're on right now does not allow for links, I think. When you try to copy and paste links in here, in the box, it blocks it for some reason, it seems like. So, if you're trying to share links, I think instead of sharing it on here, that you will be able to share it on Facebook, but I don't think, yeah, if you do like an extra letter or something to make it so that it's not a link, then people can figure it out, and it won't register as a link. So if you want, you can post it here, just make sure it doesn't recognize it as a link. So now there's a question of, were the Essenes, do I think the Essenes were really the Zadoks? And in other words, the Zadokites, which according to scholars, those were a movement, the proper priests. It seems to me that the Zadokites, well, hold on. Okay, yeah. So for the links, as I said, it seems like it's not going to work like when you copy and paste it. If you want, instead of, like, don't say HTTP and that stuff, and don't say the .com. Just give, like, the main thing and see if that works. I'm not sure, though. But, or as I said, try it on Facebook. But so the Zadokites, it seems to me that according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Essenes, you know, the scriptures, these Zadok just means righteous, and according to the Book of Ezekiel, there was to be the sons of Zadok who are to be the priests, and that is the sons of righteousness, basically righteous priests who are pure and following God's commandments. And so I believe that the I believe that the Essenes are the same group of the Dead Sea Scroll writers. I believe they're the same. And I believe that they were the righteous group. And that the Pharisees and the Sadducees were not the Zadokites. They were not the righteous. But that the Pharisees and the Sadducees originated as breaking away from the Essene group. They divided from them and formed their own heresy groups. But the Essenes, I believe, were the true group, the one that was faithful to the Zadokite way, the righteous way. Okay. But yeah, so hopefully that answers the question of... I do believe they were... The Essenes and the Zadokites were the same. And that they're not the Sadducees, they're not the Pharisees, but they're the Essenes. I'm very confident that they are the Essenes. So... Now, do you guys have more questions on your mind? I'll wait to see if there's any more questions. And I have so much to share, so, you know, if there's no questions, I'll just share whatever comes to my mind. But I'll wait for a little bit to see if there's any more questions. Lee, were you asking if we can do this until the morning? I'd be willing to do that if I was, you know, that'd be fun to do, but you know, for people, like, since this is being recorded and stuff like that, I try to keep it roughly to 2 hours. But it's variable. Like, sometimes it can be 1.5 hours if 2 hours is too much for people, or maybe a little bit longer, like 3 or possibly even 4 hours on some occasions, on rare occasions. But I think anything over like 3 or 4 hours might be a little bit too much for people to handle, and it would be a very long video to do, or, you know, to load to YouTube. So, yeah, we could do a special 24-hour teaching for the hardcore people on one of these times, maybe. But yeah, there's so much that we could do. Like, if in future we could set up something like we don't have to do this once a week, we could do this twice a week or something for those who want a little bit more, you know. And we could do this one, as I said, it's mainly designed to be about 2 hours roughly, but on other occasions, you know, if we want to do a study of scripture, like a study of, like, let's say through the Book of Enoch again, and reading through it and studying it together, we could easily do something that's like 6-8 hours, something like that, for people who really wanted to do something. Because I've had talks with people on Skype before where we've talked for like 6 hours, 7 hours at a time, So, okay, there is the question, well, it's not a question, but Kay mentioned the book Jasher, and I assume she means the Book of Jasher. I want to share my view on the Book of Jasher, and that is, when I was first coming into these extra books and the Law of Moses type thinking, that was about... let's see, that was, I think, 6 years ago, and six and a half years ago, and I accepted the Book of Jasher in the beginning, because it's, you know, the scripture says, is it not written in the Book of Jasher? And it says that in two different places, in the Book of Joshua and in 2 Samuel. So for me, that was enough. I was like, oh, okay, that must be scripture. And I accepted that for a while. But then, a year or two later, I was doing more study, and I was finding some major issues with the Book of Jasher. I was finding that what the Book of Jasher says contradicts majorly with almost every other extra book that covers the same accounts. It Like, you couldn't write a book that was more contradictory, almost, because it's so inconsistent. Like, here's a good way to know. Here's a good way to know if people that you know are truly reading these things or not. I've seen people, I used to be one of them, but then I decided to do, you know, a thorough study of it and compare the two together, and I realized, wow, this is completely contradictory. It doesn't fit. The reason people haven't done it is because the Book of Jasher is huge. I did a math of it one time, and it's like something like 25% of the entire Bible. That's how big it is, that the size of it. It's like 1/4 of the regular Bible in size. It's huge. It's massive. So the problem is, it's so huge, most people don't have the time to do an in-depth comparison like that. But I did it once, and there are people who say that they accept Jubilees and Jasher as scripture. They say both of them are scripture. The problem is, Jubilees and Jasher contradict each other as much as it possibly could. Like, almost on every page, there's major contradictions. So if you accept the Book of Jubilees, I don't see how you can really accept the Book of Jasher, the current one, anyway, that people are teaching is the correct one, because there's just too many things that cannot line up. It's impossible to... I tried it once. I tried to, like, use crazy way of interpreting to make it work, and I just couldn't, because there were certain things that just could not be reconciled. And one of those things was about Esau. When did Esau die? Who killed Esau? Major contradictions between Jubilees and Jasher. And on so many other issues, there's just huge contradictions. And we found scrolls in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Like, we found a book of Abraham. In Abraham's own words, Abraham tells us things about his life in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And what Abraham tells us is not what Jasher tells us. There's contradictions. So I would say I don't accept Jasher anymore as scripture. And there's some reasons for that, and I'll give you the reasons. It's one, the Septuagint, which is the oldest version of the Old Testament other than the Dead Sea Scrolls. The Septuagint in the Book of Joshua does not have the reference to Jasher. It does not say, as it is written in Jasher. It seems to me that the rabbis added that reference to support their rabbinic book that they wrote, the Book of Jasher. And when you look at the Book of Jasher, it agrees so much with what the rabbinic tradition teaches, like, really, like, almost all the time. Some striking agreements. So that's another issue, and there's no manuscript of it known to exist. The earliest copy of it known is from the printed version in 1625, and we have no manuscript of it. So, did it even exist before that time? We don't know. Very possible it did, but I still think it's not valid if it did exist before. It seems like it was a rabbinic writing. They never intended it to be a false thing. I think they believed what they were saying. That was their interpretation. But as you know, people can have crazy interpretations sometimes. They invent... this isn't in the Book of Jasher, but there's the whole idea of Lilith, the story of Lilith. You'll never find that in the scriptures, but that's a very... Some of the rabbis are very convinced that's true, and they have a whole story of it that they can write, and they believe it's true. Whoever wrote Jasher, I don't think they were intentionally writing falsehoods. I think they thought, I think this is what is true, so here's what I believe is true. And that was what Jasher, it was a record of what the rabbis believed. So I would say, you know, don't reject Jasher just because I tell you. But if you were to follow what I would say, I don't think it's scripture, and I would avoid it. I would avoid studying it. And it's a waste. I feel like it's a waste of time. It's a huge book, and if it's not scripture, why read such a huge book and study it, you know? Oh, and another thing is, that book, there's some stuff in there that's like very like fairy tale like. It reads like a fairy tale, and it reads like a novel, fiction, you know, and there are certain things in there that seem to go against the spirit of Genesis too. Like Genesis presents the story of Joseph. Like in the story of Genesis, we see Joseph has the upper hand. His brothers are like being taken advantage of by Joseph, and Joseph was like basically gonna ruin their lives. And Judah, in desperation, says, "Take me in my place, in the place of Benjamin. Just don't hurt Benjamin, you know." And he's at his, the way Genesis portrays it to us, the brothers are at Joseph's total mercy, and they're like weaklings, they're wimps, basically, in as the story presents it. The author of Jasher didn't like that. So they presented the 12 sons, or, you know, Joseph's brothers, in a different way. They presented them as like warriors who wouldn't be pushed around and wouldn't be taken advantage of like that. And they basically said, "Give us Benjamin or we're going to kill everybody." And it makes Judah like, it makes Judah like basically say, you know, threatening Joseph. And then Joseph only reveals himself because he's afraid for his own life and he's afraid for the lives of the Egyptians. That's a complete slant and a twisting of the Genesis story. I don't think that's correct what the Genesis story is teaching us. It's clear that Joseph had the advantage. He wasn't afraid. He wasn't scared that Judah was going to kill everybody. He had the upper hand. He could, at a moment's notice, kill them all right then and there, and they wouldn't be able to do anything about it because there are only 12 men, and there's the whole Egyptians against them. So I would say it's stuff like that that to me makes Jasher really far-fetched in many ways and contrary to the scriptures. There's so many examples. I've gone through it before in the past. So I would say I would avoid Jasher. And I don't really believe almost any of the stories in Jasher are true, unless you can find them explicitly in the other scriptures. There might be fragments of truth in it, but otherwise I'd say don't accept what it says. The thing about Esau killing Nimrod, I don't believe that. I don't think that's true. And if you read the Book of Jubilees, for instance, that reads like an Old Testament book. That has like a spirit of, wow, this is like, this reads like Torah. This reads like an authentic writing of Yah. Same thing with the Dead Sea Scrolls. You just see so much life in it, and so much authenticity, so much like depth of these writings. But when you read Jasher, it reads like a fiction. It reads like a fairy tale. You don't have the sense of it being a Old Testament book. In my take, anyway. And I think you'd see that. But if you want some fun reading, or to see what do the rabbis believe, then I recommend read the Book of Jasher, because that gives you a good idea of what the rabbis taught about how they interpreted the Book of Genesis and the Torah and some of the stories of Joshua. Hold on one second. Okay. Are there other questions people have right now, or that's a good question. I didn't answer that. I've done teaching on that in the past, but the question that Levon is asking is, hopefully I pronounced that right, how many books are there total in the Dead Sea Scrolls? Have they all been released? Where can I find a book or link online having them all? Sorry if you answered that already, he said. Well, as I said, I didn't answer that in this one, but I've done similar answers in other teachings. But basically, It's difficult to say the exact approximation of what was found because sometimes there's fragments of things. But I have a little thing that I did. I went through the writings myself, and I can tell you. Let me open it. It's from my website. I'm gonna make a website in the future specifically devoted to the Dead Sea Scroll resources, and I have all the Dead Sea Scrolls, so I can send the links to that. But I'm gonna make a website for the Dead Sea Scrolls so that people can download all the files that people, you know, everything you could ever want on the Dead Sea Scrolls. I'll have it there for you, because that's like my faith, that's my mission, the scrolls. So, so let me give you an idea of the scrolls that were found. You can't, as I said, you can't give an exact number of what, of the scrolls that were found, but let's see here. Okay, so some of this needs to be updated because they have found before I read through some of these, basically to let you know is that some of these the scrolls were published over time, but they had to be bought by the people who had them. So when they were found, the Arabs had them, and the people who had the Dead Sea Scrolls wanted to make money out of it. So when they would negotiate with the scholars over how much the scholars were going to pay for these scrolls. And it costs a lot of money for people, for scholars to get these scrolls. Even fragments can cost so much money. And so there are still fragments out there that are being acquired. They are trying to be gotten by the scholars still. And they're, the people who have them are charging, they want a lot of money for it. So there is still stuff out there trying to be acquired. The vast majority of the scrolls, as far as we know, have all been found, have all been purchased, and have been published. There's a few that are being published as we speak. So there's an updated amount. So the list I have that I went through doesn't have the full update. There's a few scrolls that I don't have recorded on my list here. So, but for the most part, this list is pretty accurate with, you know, percentage of error. But it's very unfortunate that the money dictates this process. It's very sad. So basically there was about 860 scrolls found, according to the scholars, about 860. There might be, considering all of them, there might be more like 900 scrolls. But so that's an approximate idea of the number of scrolls that were found. Of those scrolls, let's see here. One second. All right, let's see. Of the scrolls, 141 scrolls that the scholars identify, to me, it's impossible to identify those. 141 scrolls. Then there's 81 scrolls, which are texts of currently unidentified books. So we might be able to identify those books, those scrolls, with more study and more research. But right now, they cannot be identified. But they're not impossible to identify, but they might be able to in the future. Then there's 37 scrolls of prophecies, containing prophecies which are from unidentified prophets. So we know they are written by a prophet, but we don't know which prophet yet. But we might be able to identify that prophet in the future with more study. So 37 of those scrolls. Then we've got 31 phylacteries. Or tefillin, that was what you wore on the head, and what you wore on the arm. There were about 31 of those that were found. Then there was 29 copies of Deuteronomy, 29 copies of the Book of Psalms, and then there was 29 scrolls containing other apocryphal Psalms of David. So David didn't just write the Psalms of the Book of Psalms, but he wrote many other Psalms. And we have 29 scrolls containing David's other fragments of David's other Psalms. We're told in the Book of Psalms and the Dead Sea Scrolls that David wrote 3,600 Psalms, and he wrote 450 songs. That's a lot compared to, you know, what we were regularly being shown. And again, the First Kings in the Old Testament tells us that Solomon did 1,005 songs. So we're missing a lot of their songs, David's and Solomon's. But so, then we have about 23 copies of Exodus, and then there's 22 scrolls containing the Essenes' interpretations of the Law of Moses. It may be one book, but it may be multiple books. We can't know exactly for sure, but so there's interpretations of the Essenes. 22 scrolls have stuff like that. 20 copies of Genesis, 18 copies of Isaiah, 17 copies of Leviticus. Now we got, they also had 16 copies of Jubilees. So that's, you know, amazing. Jubilees is high up there on that list. And so we see that Book of Jubilees must have been important to them, one of their important books. And then about 15 copies of Damascus Document, roughly. There's some uncertainty in that counting. There's 14 copies of Community Rule. Those two, Damascus Document and Community Rule, were written by the Essenes. The 14 scrolls containing the calendar of the priests. There's about 14 different scrolls that have calendar information. There's 14 scrolls containing apocryphal wisdom. So there's some wisdom, like Proverbs, stuff like that, you know, extra, similar to Solomon, but it's apocryphal stuff, extra ones. And there's about 14 scrolls of those. 13 copies of the Book of Enoch. 10 copies of the Temple Scroll, approximately. But most of them are fragments. 10 copies of Numbers. 10 copies of David's songs for the Sabbath sacrifice. And let's see here. Then there's like about, they had Peshers, and what Peshers are is commentary. Commentary on the Dead Sea Scroll, commentary on some of the prophets or scriptures. And we have 10 copies of Peshers, or interpretations of the 12 prophets, the minor prophets. And most of the minor prophets are missing, but the best preserved is Habakkuk. That's almost, it's pretty much fully preserved. Their interpretation of Habakkuk. They interpret it prophetically. And there's also one of Hosea, Zephaniah, maybe Malachi, I think. But they're very fragmentary, the other ones, compared to the Habakkuk one. Then there's 9 copies of Giants, the Book of Giants. And that was either written by Noah or angels. It's one of those two. And that's a similar book. It's very similar to the Book of Enoch. It's another Enoch book. So there was 9 copies of that. Then there is 9 copies of an extra book of Jeremiah. There was an Apocrypha of Jeremiah. That's very few fragments of that, but there's about 9 copies of that. 8 copies of the War Scroll. Very important document for end times. And I can give you all a link to all these documents. I will give you the link to my website, and all the files are there that you can see all the files. See, there is 8 copies of David's Psalms of Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving Psalms. David did some special psalms that scholars call the Thanksgiving Psalms or the Hodayot. I believe it was written by David. There's so many things in it that point it to David being the author. And it's prophetic. It's just like the Book of Psalms, but even more, like, it's more personal to David, and there's some really amazing prophecies in there. So there's 8 copies of those. Really, really good one. 8 copies of the 12 prophets. So they're, you know, Hosea, Joel, Amos, you know, all those. The 12 prophets of the regular Bible, there was 8 copies of those. 8 copies of the Book of Daniel. There was 8 mezuzahs. So just like, you know, there's the box that you wear on the head and on your arm, there's the box that was the Tefillin. There's mezuzahs, which you hang on the doorposts, or the gates. There was 8 of those found. There was 8 scrolls containing, they had commentary on the Book of Genesis. They had some extra, like, their interpretation of Genesis, some extra information of how they interpreted certain parts. There's like about 8 scrolls containing their take on Genesis. It's possible some of those scrolls might be from lost prophet books and not by the Essenes, but right now I'm identifying it as Essene authorship. 7 copies of the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. The Patriarchs are the 12 Patriarchs are the sons of Jacob. And so, you know, Levi, Judah, Reuben, Simeon, you know, all the 12. They all wrote words of prophecy before they died. They wrote words of teaching to their children, of morals, of do this, I want you to be righteous, and make sure you follow this. You know, don't do these sins, don't be foolish like I did, or be wise like I was, you know, that type of thing. And there's some amazing stuff in those. And 7 copies of those were found, but most of them contain the Testament of Levi. There was a couple fragments of the Testament of Naphtali, and there may have been a Testament of Judah in there, and a Testament of Joseph, but they were very fragmentary and hard to really know for certain. But what they originally had there was all 12 of the patriarchs had their testaments, but unfortunately, not too much was preserved in the scrolls of those testaments. That's some amazing stuff, the Testaments. So much powerful prophecies there. Then there's 7 copies of a book of wisdom which overlaps. The scholars call it instruction. 7 copies of instruction. And it's always the same author. It's all the same book. So there were 7 copies of this special wisdom book. We don't know who wrote it, but I probably believe it was written by... I think it was probably by Solomon. Then there's 7 copies of the Essenes' Pesher to the Isaiah. They did an interpretation of the Book of Isaiah. There was about 7 copies of those. And then there's 7 copies of what seems to be a extra book. It was either by Daniel or Habakkuk, and it was about Daniel's life. About further things that Daniel did. So 7 copies of that. There is 7 copies approximately of an extra book of Joshua that was found. Very fragmentary though. Let's see here. 7 copies of community blessings and prayers. They had blessings and prayers for their community. 7 copies of those. 6 copies of a prophecy about New Jerusalem. I believe Moses wrote this because there's some indications to me that indicates that it was Moses. It's similar to Ezekiel. Ezekiel 40, you know, the later chapters of Ezekiel prophesying of the New Jerusalem. And I believe it was by Moses, and there's 6 copies of those. And there's some striking agreements between the New Jerusalem and the Temple Scroll. And so I think I've seen other descriptions of some of Moses's, what was shown to Moses in extra books, and one of the things he was shown is the New Jerusalem. So I believe that the New Jerusalem book of prophecy was written by Moses, and that's why Ezekiel, when he had his prophecy in of the New Jerusalem, he was not showing something new, but he was condensing the material from the Temple Scroll and from the New Jerusalem prophecy that Moses had. That's my take on it. There are 6 copies of Ezekiel, 6 scrolls containing extra book of Moses. It's not exactly clear what that book was, but there's extra stuff about Moses, which seems to be from another book, another apocryphal book. And we know that there was another book of Moses. We know that there was 2 extra books. Jude quotes them. It's the Testament of Moses and the Assumption of Moses. So he quotes them as scripture, Jude, in the New Testament. So we know that those are there was another Moses book. So 6 scrolls of Moses Apocrypha. There were 6 copies of Job. 5 copies of the Testament of Amram. Now, who was Amram? Amram was the father of Moses and Aaron. And there's some great, amazing stuff in this Testament of Amram. The final words of the father of Moses. And it was addressed to Moses. And it corresponds with the Book of Jubilees very well. There's 5 copies of an extra book of Ezekiel. An extra book of prophecy. The church fathers had this book. They considered it scripture, the early ones. They quoted from it. And there was fragments of it found in Greek. And And Josephus says that Ezekiel had 2 books of prophecy. Well, we know the 1 book in the regular Bible of Ezekiel, but there's the 2nd one found in the scrolls, and I truly believe it was by Ezekiel. But so there was 5 copies of those. 5 copies of 1st and 2nd Samuel, 5 copies of the book of Tobit, and then there was 5 blessing psalms. I believe those were by David, so there's 5 copies of the blessing psalms. Then there's 4 scrolls containing messianic prophecy. 4 scrolls containing messianic prophecy. 4 copies of Jeremiah, 4 of Judges, 4 copies of a prophecy of mysteries. Okay, mysteries prophecy. It's unsure which prophet wrote that, but one of the prophets wrote that. And 4 copies, there seems to be a pesher to the Psalms that they did, an interpretation of the book of Psalms. It was 4 copies of that. And there is a prophecy about the tribe of Joseph. The tribe of Joseph. There was 4 copies of this prophecy found. It was from a larger book, which we don't know the exact prophet who wrote that. But then there's 4 copies of Ruth, 4 of Lamentations, 4 of Song of Solomon, 3 of 1st and 2nd Kings, 3 scrolls containing, it seems to be, words from Jacob, Judah, and Joseph. So it might be all one book, maybe different books, but extra words of the patriarchs. There were festival songs of David. We are told in the book of Psalms that David wrote 30 songs, 1 each for each of the festivals. And there were festival songs found in the scrolls, so I believe they were written by David. There were 3 of those. Then there was 3 scrolls containing historical references to the Maccabean era. So there are 3 scrolls that talk about things that happened by the Maccabees. And then 3 scrolls containing just lists of names. We don't know if that's from another book or something. Another book of prophecy or something. I don't know. 2 copies of Songs of the Sage, which I suspect it's probably by Solomon, writing those songs, but maybe it was by David. 2 copies of the book of Joshua, 2 copies of the book of Proverbs, 2 of Ecclesiastes. Then there's 2 copies of interpretation of prophecy. It's the same interpretation that was found in 2 different copies. And then there's 2 scrolls that are just, it seems to be just quotations of scripture. Just quotations. No narrative, no teaching. It's just quoting scripture one after another. Let's see here. And then we have a bunch of, there's a, we're getting close to the end of this list here. There's, let's see, there is 2 copies of a prayer meditating on biblical history, 2 copies of an extra Samuel prophecy book, two copies of an apocryphal Chronicles. So just like the Book of Chronicles, there was another, there was an apocryphal Chronicles, and we're told in First and Second Chronicles about this extra Chronicles book. So it seems like this other Chronicles book is that book that we're told was written, but it's only a small copies of it. Fragment. Let's see here. Then there's a document the scholars call the Ages of Creation. There were two scrolls of that, containing Ages of Creation. Two scrolls that just have curses. And then we found an amazing scroll. This is like probably one of the most important of all. It's called the Genesis Apocryphon. And in that one scroll, there was a copy of the Book of Lamech, a copy of the Book of Noah. So Noah actually wrote that book. And then the copy of the Book of Abraham. And Abraham wrote that book. So Genesis Apocryphon, it's called. And that's like one of the key ones of all the scrolls. It was one copy of the Testament of Kohath. Who was Kohath? That was Moses' grandfather. So he wrote his last words, prophecy, stuff like that. Wrote it down. We have one copy of that. Fragmentary. We have a revelation of Gabriel. It was found on a stone. And I believe that to be authentic. Some scholars don't, but I think it's authentic and an amazing prophecy of the Messiah. And there is the copper scroll. There was one copy of that found. It's like basically giving treasure. It seems like it's the temple treasure. So there's one of that. There was one copy of the four songs of David for exorcism. We're told in the scrolls that he did that. He did those four songs, and we found those four songs. Then there's a copy of a book very similar to the Book of Esther. It's around the same time period. It's in during the reign of Darius, and it's a book of Petariza and Begazro. It seems like there's a copy of First Maccabees, but it's not entirely certain. It seems like there's at least one copy of that. Then there's a copy of Wisdom of Sirach, and a copy of Epistle of Jeremiah. And there was also a copy of the Prayer of Manasseh. So far, like, wow, this is like amazing stuff. This is these are, you know, the Apocrypha in the scrolls. And let's see, there's one copy of a Melchizedek commentary. It's called a Melchizedek text, and it has like it interprets the Messiah as Melchizedek, and that strikingly fits with Hebrews. The Book of Hebrews talks about that as well. There's a copy of one copy of Ezra that was found, one of Nehemiah, one of First and Second Chronicles. And there's only like 10 left of the list, okay? There's one copy of an apocryphon of Michael to Malachi. The prophet Malachi wrote another book. There's one copy of a prophecy about the coming of Elijah. We don't know who did this prophecy, but a prophecy of Elijah coming. A copy of a chronological text. Then there's a copy of Beatitudes prophecy. So you know how the Messiah in the New Testament had Beatitudes? Well, there are Beatitudes in the Dead Sea Scrolls. One copy of that was found. There's a copy of Two Ways, which is similar to the Didache. It was a copy of a Two Ways type of document, similar in theme to the Didache, but very fragmentary. There was one copy found which has a prophecy about the judges. So you know the Book of Judges, there was the stories in that. There's actually a prophecy of the judges, a story in the Book of Judges, and there's a prophecy about it. So that means it was written before the Book of Judges, which is amazing. Then there's an unknown seer. We have a copy of some unknown seer. There was a parable from a copy. There is a blessing. And then there's a liturgy. The scholars call it liturgy office. It was a copy of that. So that's all the scrolls that were found. That was a long list, but hopefully that gives you guys a good idea of what was there. There's some amazing stuff in there. So much depth in these scrolls. And I can give you the links on my website. And so Yeah, and some people think the New Testament was in the Dead Sea Scrolls. I don't think there is. There's not really much evidence for that. And as for Didache, I think that's legitimate. I think it's scripture, but I think, like, I've found other versions of Didache which are much longer than that. So I'm of the belief that probably the longer version is more original, and the Didache is the shortened version. Yeah, hopefully that was very illuminating for you guys of knowing what's there, because there's so many scrolls and people haven't taken the time to read through that. So I hope that was eye-opening for you guys in some sense of what is really there. So let's see, how long has this been going on? Okay, we are at the hour and 10-minute mark. I want to do this for at least 20 more minutes, but if any of you have to go sooner, you can. This is being recorded, so the rest of it you can listen to. But I'm going to stay at least 20 more minutes. And for those who want to go a little bit longer, we might go up to the 2-hour mark. But I don't want to really go any farther than the 2 hours. So do you guys have more? I gave you a lot of, like all that, those extra books that I gave listed. So that might plant some more questions in your mind. But so do you guys have any questions of anything I've said or any things on your mind unrelated to what I said? Oh, wait. There was one question that I forgot to answer earlier, and that is, the question about the New Testament and his name still written in the Hebrew form. Do I know of a New Testament that has the Messiah's name still in the Hebrew font? And I don't know one off the top of my hand. It's not as important to me to have a copy of it, because I know it in my head, so I don't need to see it myself. I know when I make my own copy in the future, then I will, do it. Do his name as I believe should be done. But I'm not sure of the best one to recommend to you that has his name in it. But there are so many Hebrew roots version of the New Testament. I'm sure you could find. I do know there are ones out there that have his name in those Hebrew letters, and you can find it. I just don't know which one it is. I don't remember the name of it. But yeah, so are there other questions that you guys have? And I'm just stepping out of the room for a quick second. I'm just going to get a drink of water. But so please ask your questions if you have something on your mind. All right. Sorry for that delay. Let's see here. Just checking to see if anyone's trying to come in. Okay. And the same question was asked for the Old Testament. There are versions out there. I just don't know which, like, to recommend you to point you to. But if you just type in Google "sacred name Bible Old Testament" or "sacred name New Testament" or "New Testament in Paleo Hebrew" or "Old Testament in Paleo Hebrew." I think you'll find it through that way. I find, like, doing those type of searches, I find so many resources when I do stuff like that. So I think there is one you can find. Unfortunately, a lot of them don't like to share the scriptures for free. they want you to buy the copy to have it in Hebrew. But there are some who share it online. So if you can find one online, it's preferable. And I'll just let you know that I share all my resources for free. I don't charge people for my resources. So now if you want book copies of it, then, you know, obviously there needs money to produce the materials. But it doesn't cost money to have it free PDFs. So I just, you know, all the stuff I have, I share with people. Whether it's my own work or whether it's other people's work. So just be wary of people who charge and who don't give away the scriptures for free. That's what you want to avoid. Those type of people. Because they're not... They have their primary interest, it seems, is money rather than preaching the truth to people. So, there's a question of, was Cain the serpent's seed, a Nephilim, in other words, according to any other writings other than Pseudo-Jonathan? And I'm not entirely certain it's Pseudo-Jonathan. It might actually have been by Jonathan, but basically, you know, the Jonathan one is a targum of it's a translation of the book of the law of Moses, but this particular one adds so much extra details of interpretation and commentary. And oh, and by the way, some of those extra details agree with the book of Jasher. Just a little trivia there. So, Cain, let's see, the Gnostic writings in Nag Hammadi library. There are many writings there which have that teaching of Cain being the serpent seed. I don't know of any writing of Apocrypha, of those type of writings, teaching that. I don't see a writing in the Dead Sea Scrolls, for instance, that teaches that. In my view, you know, it's Book of Jubilees tells us, and the other scriptures tell us that Cain was the son of Adam and Eve, and there was no strange things going on with Adam and Eve. They were the only ones that were with each other according to the other books. They didn't have other husbands or wives or other lovers. So all the people on the earth came from Adam and Eve according to the Book of Jubilees. And Jubilees in the Dead Sea Scrolls and for myself is foundational to the faith. It is like more authoritative than the Book of Genesis, actually. To give an example, there are certain things in all copies of the Book of Genesis which disagree with the Book of Jubilees in certain details. I agree with Jubilees over Genesis because Genesis has certain things which cannot be true. It has certain because of the differences in the manuscripts, it shows that Genesis was heavily edited to fit what people wanted to believe. They didn't add stuff, but they altered stuff often. We have multiple copies of Genesis from different groups, and in each group there are major differences. And we see that none of those copies are perfect, that they have errors in it. Each one has alterations from the original version. And so, Jubilees to me is chief authority. It has almost no errors in it. There are some though, because scribes were copying it, you know. There's always errors when scribes copy. Mistakes, words they forgot to put in, or they missed a line accidentally. Stuff like that. But otherwise, Jubilees I trust as the ultimate authority. So, according to Jubilees, all humans came from Adam and Eve. Cain married his sister. So it's none of that. Cain married other people that were already there. Jubilees is very clear on it. Jubilees disagrees with the idea of evolution, of a long Earth, you know, of theistic evolution of billions of years. We're basically told in Jubilees that during the first week of 7 days, Jubilees tells us the creation happened, and then in the second week, Adam named all the animals. Certain animals on one day, animals on the next day, animals on the next day for 5 days. And Jubilee says that was in the second week of days. So that proves to us that according to the scripture, the evolution idea of billions of years is not reconcilable with what the scriptures say. So yeah, there is no Cain and serpent seed stuff in these other books. That the Nephilim stuff comes later. It comes after Enoch is born. So when Enoch was born, they hadn't done that yet. It only came after. And let's see here. Lee, I don't know if you were asking me where I live. You said, are you close to Oklahoma? But now about the calendar, yeah, the lunar comes in 10 days too soon as compared to the solar year and compared to the seasons. So if you follow the lunar without adding extra time, you're going to fall away from the seasons, and eventually your seasons are going to be completely off. The end of your lunar year is going to be, it's going to start, you know, near spring, but then the next year it's going to go farther back into winter, farther back into winter the following year, and then eventually it's going to be before winter. It's going to be in fall when your lunar year ends. This is exactly what we see with Islam. Islam follows a lunar calendar, which is not adjusted by an extra time being added. So some years we have two Ramadan holy times in the same year. Ramadan is the Muslim holy time, and they do that twice in a year sometimes because of the lunar year losing 10 days from the true year. So are there other questions that people have on your mind? What do you guys, what comes to your mind? Okay, there's a question about the calendar again, and it's, does the equinox set the first day in the fall? So there's the spring equinox and there's the fall equinox. Basically, Enoch gives us the laws of the seasons, and he tells us that for each season, there's 91 days, or rather, there's 90 days, and then there's the extra day, which is the equinox, or the solstice. So, well, according to Enoch, we're told there's the spring equinox, and then there's 90 days. Then there's the fall, summer solstice, and then there's 90 days. Then there is the fall equinox, and there's 90 days, and then there's the winter, and then there's 90 days, and then it's the new year. That's 364, so the new year begins. So according to Enoch, what we have to do is figure out the correct time when the equinox, spring equinox, is, and then 181 days later, that is when fall. Yeah, that's when fall is set. So the problem is, if you're not keeping the calendar correctly, your fall start will be very far off from the correct start. So a way of figuring out that you're keeping it properly is checking to see, is your fall beginning when it really is beginning? Because if it's not, if it's too far away, then you're doing Enoch's calendar wrong. But you don't adjust it. You don't adjust it in the year. You start out, and if you're starting out correctly, all you do is count from that point on. You just count, okay, 90 days to the next season. Okay, 90 days to the next season. Okay, 90 days to the next season. You keep doing that. So you don't have to wait until the equinox happens. You just know, oh, it's going to come because Enoch told us it's going to come. But to make sure you're doing it correctly, you look for the equinox to make sure that you're in line with his laws. And something to note is that what the scholars say the equinox is not the true equinox. There's a lot of evidence I've found for this to be the case. And basically, they're off by about 7 minutes of time it takes of daylight. 7 minutes of daylight. They're off by about 7 minutes of daylight. That's significant. In certain places of the world, 7 minutes of daylight is an entire month of change. So in other words, the equinox, when that happens, is determined based on how much sunlight is there compared to the night. The problem is the scientists are determining it incorrectly. According to the scrolls, a day begins when the sun is halfway below the diameter, with its middle on the horizon. That's when it begins. That's what the Dead Sea Scrolls explicitly says in the Damascus document. But scientists are not doing it by that diameter. They're doing it by the little tip, the final little speck of the sun. That's when the sunset or sunrise is. That's a problem because it's going to throw off how long your day is by your count. And when it throws off your count, it's throwing off when the equinox is. So, it according to what the scholars are saying, you know, September 23rd was the equinox. But in my view, it was earlier than that. And that's based on their... I think in some places they say that, like, the equinox was, like, almost around the 26th or 27th in some places. Like, so it's really off how they're doing it. When you're counting it properly, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, it's going to line up exactly as Enoch told us. If you start it correctly with the equinox, guaranteed it's 90 days after is the next season, and then 90 days after that next season, 90 days after, you know. So it's going to follow that every time. See here. Oh yeah, and so sundials will throw you off for the reason I mentioned, is because there's still sunlight. Like, as I said, the sun, when it's halfway below the horizon and halfway above, that's when the Dead Sea Scroll says the new day begins. The problem is your sundial is still registering sunlight even when the day is already over, and it's still slightly above. So there's about 7 minutes of time there that it takes to fully set from that amount. And so the sundial is actually adding like 7 minutes of time that's not really there as part of your day. So it's going to throw off your time. So what you really want to do is be able to find a way to know when the sun is... where the sun is in the sky when it's setting. You can use a sundial as an approximation, but you don't want to use it as the exact how many days are in the year, when the seasons begin, because it's going to be off from the Dead Sea Scroll reckoning. Now, there was a sundial, it seems, that was found in the scrolls, but it probably was working differently than how the sundials we use today. And the question was asked, when is the Jubilee year? Let's see here. I've worked it out when the The last one that I figured out was, I think it was either 1997, may have been 1997, maybe. When I, according to the math that I did, the year of Jubilee. So, 49 years after that, and then the 50th year. So that brings us to, like, a little bit after 2040. So that's a good guess. Like, that's, you know, pretty close, like, more like 2045 about, around there. I didn't do the exact math in my head, but right around there is when it'll be. And then Tishri, I sometimes forget the names. Is that the first day of fall, are you saying, Tishri 1? Okay. That, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, always begins on the fourth day of the week. And that began, I began it this year. Let's see, when was it? It was the 16th, or rather the 15th. It was the sunset on the 15th, evening of the 15th of September. That's when it began it. So, yeah. And I think it always begins right around that time, every year. Let's see here. Alright, we're at the 1 hour and 30 minutes. So, for those who need to leave, they can leave now, but if not, we'll keep going probably for another 30 minutes for those who want to stay. And please just, you know, ask whatever, because when you ask unique and interesting questions, it makes the recording much more beneficial to people, because you could make it go in any direction. You could ask any question, and it really directs, you know, you can direct the flow of the study. And that's what I really like about this, because it gives you guys a little bit of control over the content. And so I did 3 studies before this. So for those, if you haven't listened to those, I really recommend if you like this one, that you listen to those first 3 as well. And there's some really good stuff in those first 3. And I'm going to be trying to do this once a week. I might change it to a different day. Instead of Wednesdays, it might be some other day. But I still have to figure that out. But for now, I'll still be doing it on Wednesdays. But yeah, so are there other questions? Oh, I didn't see that you had asked that. Sorry if I missed that. My apologies. Okay. So the question is, the 7-day cycle. Has it ever been altered? And yeah, I can email you guys, I'm going to give you guys my email. See if that works. Oh, yeah. Can you guys see that? It's, I typed it there. It's oneiu777@gmail.com. You can email me there, or you can find me on Facebook. And, from there, I'll share all my findings with you all. If there's any major things to announce, you'll have contact there, and I can email you guys as well. So the 7-day cycle, has it ever been altered, was the question. And that's the week is 7 days, and I believe that whatever day is the correct time, I believe in a 7 cycle always that's unaltered. Now there's other calendars out there which teach that it gets altered, and I don't agree with that. So I think, you know, whenever the Sabbath is, it's always that day of the week, every year, forever. So if the true Sabbath is on a Friday, it's always Friday, every year, forever. If it's a Saturday, you know, forever. If it's Wednesday, then it's forever too. So I'm confident that whatever the correct day is, that's the day it always is. But in terms of figuring out the correct one, that's a little bit more tricky, and you have to do that. There might be a way of using the moon and stuff like that to figure it out, but right now we have to kind of depend on the history, that we have to depend on history to tell us when the week, days of the week changed. And here's what I can tell you, is that from my study, everything from Israel to the west is on the correct day. It is the sunset before. So Saturday, or, you know, seventh day, begins the evening before, on Friday evening. I believe that's when the Sabbath begins. I think that's the correct seventh cycle. However, I'm not sure if you guys have heard of the International Dateline. That's an arbitrary line that the people of the world decided to draw, and it's not a straight line. It's zigzags all over the place. You know, and it goes all the way down the ocean, zigzagging everywhere. It goes around islands. When it would exclude an island on one side, it goes over here so that it doesn't go on the other side. Like, it was drawn by men. And so the problem with that is, where is the true international dateline? Where is Yah's line? Because we don't have the right to draw our own lines, and that's what they have done. So, just to show how this makes a problem, it's already been known to make a problem. There is one nation, I don't remember the nation's name, where basically they've done this twice, two or three times actually. They changed which side of the line they wanted to be on. At one time, they were on this side, and then they said, let's go to the other side, so their day changed by 24 hours in a single second. But that's arbitrary. You can't just do that. Because whose time are we on? Ours or Yah's time? Obviously, it's not ours. So to draw our own lines like that is very iffy at best. So that's a major problem. I'm not entirely certain where the true international dateline is. In my view, it's Israel or the Promised Land. It's possible that the international dateline is the east coast of Asia. Maybe that's the case. But I think it's much more likely that it's like the Promised Land of Israel. And so basically, if that's true, that Israel is the line, everything to the east of Israel and the west of the international dateline is off by a whole day, 24-hour day. They're completely off. So that's a huge majority of the population. That's like half the world. More than half the world. That's China, India, right there. That's like 3 billion people. And you got all those other nations in Asia. Pretty much all of Asia is at the wrong time. If I'm correct that the international dateline in Yah's eyes is Israel. And some people don't understand the concept of international dateline, but it's an absolutely necessary concept. Because if you keep going, you're going to start back where you began. And it makes a problem, because if you keep doing that, all of a sudden, when you're going to be back at the same spot, it'll be one day and the same day at the same time, which is impossible. It can't be two different days. So we have to find a line where that's the start. And then it goes like that, and the people over here have to wait until it comes back to them. So wherever it starts, that's when the day first began, and they have to wait. And so my view is, it's where Israel is, the Promised Land, and everything to the east of it is a whole day off, which means, if that's true, the true Sabbath for them is on Saturday sunset. It begins actually Saturday sunset. So I would say that's the only thing that I would say is off, is those groups. Those groups are, I think they're keeping it on the wrong 7 day. Like, their 7 day is off. Their cycle has been altered. I think for the rest of the world, though, it has not been altered. I think the history from the time of the apostles up to now has been very consistent. There's so many records and documentation. It's been seven cycle after seven cycle continuously. So hopefully that helps. see here. And then it was a question, so no matter which calendar we use, his seven cycle, Yahuwah's seven day cycle is still being observed. Well, in some calendars, they're not 7 day cycle. And there were changes in certain calendars where they were doing 10 days or stuff like that. But the vast majority of the world follows a 7 day cycle. And it's the same cycle everywhere, essentially. But I do know that certain places begin the week on a different day of the week. Like in Italian, I think, I was trying to set up, this event last week, and I had my Facebook in Italian just for fun. My Facebook, was showing me Italian stuff, and I got confused, and I accidentally scheduled it for Thursday briefly. Because I was doing I picked the fourth day of the week. I didn't realize that what I had picked was Thursday. So the Italian calendar, for some reason, starts on a Monday. I don't know why. But so there's things like that where there are some differences, but otherwise, you know, pretty much it's the same 7 day cycle everywhere in the world. Let's see here. Yeah, so in the Dead Sea Scrolls, there is mention of the festival of new wine and the festival of new oil. These are holy times we're commanded to observe, which are not in our Bibles. But they're in the Dead Sea Scrolls, they're in the Temple Scroll, they're in some other fragments of the law which are found. And they're mentioned in the Book of Jubilees. It mentions this. And amazingly, we see this all throughout the Old Testament. It says stuff like, it talks about new wheat, new wine, and new oil. Always in that order. The prophets mention those. It's amazing because it mentions that all the time. So we see that, according to the prophets, this is true. There is a threefold thing of the first fruits of wheat, wine, and oil. You can find it in different passages. If you search on BibleGateway.com, for instance, just search like new wine or something and look at all the verses, and you'll see in the verses that have new wine, it usually has immediately following new oil. And immediately preceding, it often has new grain. And so these are just all it is are holy days for the harvest. And they're feasting days. And just like you have in the Old Testament, you have Passover and you have a second Passover. We also have Shavuot, Feast of Weeks, the first one. Then we have a second one and then a third one in the Temple Scroll. The Dead Sea Scrolls teach us that. And for Tabernacles, there's a second Tabernacles as well, according to some of the Apocrypha, which is Hanukkah. Hanukkah is the second Tabernacles. So it would make sense, like, if there's a second Passover, it would make sense for there to be a second Shavuot, a second Tabernacles. That makes sense. So that's the take on that. There's multiple instances of these festivals. The wine and the oil are not Sabbath days, though, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls. They are just festival days. So they're not annual Sabbaths, but they are days of holiness for the primarily relevant for the priesthood. And the Dead Sea Scroll writings speak of these festivals in the calendar documents. So I think they are true feasts and that they were originally in Moses' writings. Let's see here. Yeah, I talked about this in one of the previous ones, so I won't go in as much detail of it, but basically the question is, do you have any idea of where we may be in time, since the Septuagint, Samaritan, and Masoretic texts are all different? Basically, as you said, they're all different, so I don't trust them. as reliable. As I told you, that's one of the main reasons I trust Jubilees as more authoritative than Genesis, because Jubilees hasn't been as tampered with in regards to the chronology. So I take Jubilees' statements as the truth. The Exodus happened 2,410 years from creation. Then I take what 1 Kings told us. 480 years from the time of the Exodus to the building of the first temple. Then I take 1 and 2 Chronicles and 1 and 2 Kings, do all the dates, go all the way to when Cyrus makes his proclamation. And that's 490 years. I count it. 490 years. 490. And then the book of Daniel tells us that there is about 490 years from the time of Cyrus's decree all the way to when the Messiah, the years, the 7-year period that the Messiah dies as atonement. That's in Daniel chapter 9. And so that gives us a strong indication of when we are. We just take the year, we just take when the Messiah died, and we backtrack. We use Daniel to backtrack, okay? 490 years prior, okay, 490 years before that, okay, 490 years before that, and then 2,400 years before that, and that's the year of creation. So, based on that count, we're in, the year 6,007 is like 2,173, something like that, 2,173, so where we are right now is like, I think we're around, I think it was 5,840 years, something like that, from the creation. So hopefully that helps you. I would say, you know, for the dates of those Septuagint, Samaritan, and Masoretic, I believe the Samaritan is closer to the original text than the other two. The Samaritan agrees with Jubilees for the pre-flood patriarchs. Masoretic and Septuagint contradicted. But all three of them contradict Jubilees on the patriarchs after. But I think the Samaritan represents the closer text to the original. And this question is, how credible do I think Rachel Elior is? I mentioned in the other video, in the other teaching I did, that I'm not so much respecting, or I respect scholars, but I don't really take them seriously. I don't give them much consideration because they are not true believers as we are. They don't believe in the divinely inspired nature of these documents. So I think that when you don't accept the divine inspiration of these things, it makes you very, you lose a lot of credibility, at least for me. So I don't give a lot of credibility for her and other scholars because they're, in a sense, they're almost atheists in regards to the scriptures. They might not be atheists in regards to a god. They probably believe that there is a god. But they're not believers like we are. They don't accept the divine inspiration of the scriptures at all. So Rachel Elior has some good things. She agrees with the calendar of the scrolls being the correct one. But I think because she doesn't accept the authority of the scrolls in the sense of divinely inspired nature, she's going to come with a lot of false conclusions, and her, you know, the scholarly community respects her as a scholar, but they don't agree with everything she says, not by any measure. They reject certain things she says because some things that she says are her own opinion without having established the proof of what she is saying. So she has some good ideas, but I would avoid most of what she's saying because she spins a narrative of what she thinks happened, and most of that perhaps is true, but some of it may not be, and she's just kind of guessing. But she's not telling you that she's guessing. She's taking her guesses as if they were facts, and I have a problem with that. And that's what scholars are doing. They do that all the time, where they guess, but then they convince themselves that their guess is proof. It's proven, when really it's not. So, yeah, just Rachel Ellier may be one of the better scholars in the sense that she agrees with the Essenes as being the truest form of Judaism to its original form. But she's not an Essene. She's not a convert to their faith. So obviously there's a disconnect there of she thinks they're the true form of Judaism and yet she's not an Essene. So that kind of indicates to us that she doesn't take them seriously. So it seems like she takes them more seriously than other scholars. So I'll say that she seems to be have more, give them more importance. Oh, wait, excuse me. She doesn't think the Essenes exist, but she believes the Zadokites, I think, existed. Which, I don't know why she doesn't think the Essenes existed, because it seems to me that the Essenes and the Zadokites were the same. But, yeah, so that's one of the reasons I don't agree with her, because she doesn't even think the Essenes existed, when I think there's good evidence that they did. But she's just kind of playing a name game, because she believes the Dead Sea Scroll writers existed. So she's just not wanting to call them Essenes. So I like her for thinking that the Dead Sea Scroll writer group is the closest to the original, like the most authentic Judaism out there. You don't get that by most scholars. Most scholars think it's just another form that's authentic. And it's an alternative form of expression of Judaism, but it's just as important as Pharisee, you know, like they don't put more importance in it, whereas she kind of does. So I like that about her. But anyways, that's kind of my take on her. Now, I don't understand if there was a question about the Melchizedek priesthood. Could you clarify about that? That was by David. And it's going to be about eight more minutes, and then we'll end it probably around that time. Because it's in 8 minutes, it'll be about 2 hours. So, right, and about, like, you know, the scholars think, you know, for the evolution stuff, like dinosaurs being millions of years ago, you know, that type of stuff makes them not have as much credibility in my eyes. Of course, in their perspective, I lose a lot of credibility in their eyes because of a lot of what I believe. So it kind of goes both ways. We lose credibility in each other's eyes based on what we think. A true seeker of truth, however, despite their loss of credibility from the other perspective, tries to still be open to their viewpoint, even though they're skeptical. So we should still try to be open to what people are saying. Now, I just want to say, this isn't a question, but I just want to comment on the Samaritan Torah. And I think the Samaritan Torah is infinitely superior to the Masoretic text, hands down. You know, if I had to choose between the two, without question, there's no hesitation in my mind, I'll give you the Samaritan. It seems that the Samaritan is sometimes better than the Septuagint, and sometimes the Septuagint is better than the Samaritan. So it seems like the Septuagint preserves a form of the Samaritan Torah, which is older and more authentic in certain places, but then sometimes has been altered towards the Masoretic in certain instances. But I would say, usually I go with the Septuagint as more authoritative, and then the Samaritan Torah is a close second. That's at least for... there's many exceptions to that rule, though. Like, for instance, in the book of Exodus and the book of Numbers, there are huge extra passages found only in the Samaritan Torah. It's not in the Septuagint or the Masoretic. The Dead Sea Scrolls have these extra passages, too. So it shows the Dead Sea Scrolls confirm to us that the Samaritan text has some like it's really important and it's on the same par as Septuagint. You really what you want to do is to figure out the original version of the Law of Moses is take the Septuagint as the main your default text, then any passages in the Septuagint any passages in the Samaritan which are not in the Septuagint, add those in to your version. So you take the Septuagint as your base, add in the Samaritan, and then consult the Dead Sea Scrolls and incorporate those readings, and that I believe is we can reconstruct the original form of the Torah very closely using that process. Now I thought they already published that there's the Abisha scroll of the Samaritan, and I thought they already had published that, but maybe not. But there's English translation of the Samaritan, and there is Hebrew transcription of the Samaritan as well. They're great resources, and I've done work through the whole Bible, and I've gone through and made the marks and shown for so many of these books where there's huge differences. So there's 5 minutes or like 4 minutes left. I'm going to tell you just a little bit about these differences, just to kind of, and we can go into more detail about some of these differences in the future if you guys continue to come and participate in these studies. So basically, there's 24 books of the Old Testament, the standard Old Testament. Of all these books, there's some books which are mostly the same in the Septuagint and the Masoretic. And in those ones, I say that those are probably preserved pretty much in their original form. There's a few of those. In others, the Septuagint seems to be really altered from the original version. Those would be like the Book of Job and the Book of Jeremiah. In the Septuagint version, so many passages are missing that are in the Masoretic text, which leads me to conclude that in those cases, the Septuagint is inferior in regards to content, but it may preserve sometimes Hebrew text that's more original. So you have, in the books that differ the most between the Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Masoretic text, the main differences you have are extra passages in one, not in the other. So extra passages, then there are different order, rearranged order, and then there's alterations. So in one version it'll say this, but in another it'll say something very different. It's the same place where the word is supposed to be, but there's two different renderings that completely have a different sense and meaning. These changes, unfortunately, occur so often for all the books of the 24 books of the Old Testament. The worst ones, I'll tell you, are Genesis. What happened with Genesis? The Septuagint, Samaritan, and the Dead Sea Scrolls have so many extra details as compared to the Hebrew Genesis that everyone's familiar with. In English translations, Genesis is missing a lot of details that the original Genesis had. Same thing for the Book of Exodus. There's a lot of extra passages, a lot of details missing in the Hebrew one that we have, that we use, which are in the other copies. Leviticus, I haven't gone so much through that, but from what I've looked at, it's mostly the same, but there are some differences. But it's one of the better books of the Torah preserved. Book of Numbers, altered in the same, very similar to how Exodus was altered. Some major differences. Missing a lot of stuff, details, you know. And then my controversial claim, but which I believe I have sufficient evidence for, is the Deuteronomy one, and that's the Temple Scroll is the original version of Deuteronomy. And if that's true, that means the original version of Deuteronomy was like two times the size, and chapters 12 all the way to 20 six were in a different order, like a hugely different order, and having so many extra passengers. Joshua and Judges and Ruth are basically the same in all the copies, but there are some, you know, minor differences. So those are one of the those are some of the better books preserved. Then there is 1 and 2 Samuel. Our copies of 1 and 2 Samuel in the Hebrew text that people are familiar with in most translations is horrible compared to the original version. Septuagint, the Dead Sea Scrolls, have a much fuller version, so many extra passages. More so for 1 Samuel, but still, in 2 Samuel, there's a lot of extra stuff in it, too. So many extra details. 1 and 2 Kings, there's some major differences as well. There are... the 1 Kings is the one that's mainly the main different one. The 2 Kings is mostly, you know, not, it's mostly the same. There are some important differences, but it's really 1 Kings that's hugely different. The first 15 chapters or so are like in a really different order, like really rearranged, and has some extra stuff in the Septuagint version that's not in the Hebrew one. And then there's chapters like 20 and 21, I think it is, of the Septuagint version is reversed. It's in the Septuagint, it's 21, then 20. I think it's 20, 21, or it might be 19, 20. I don't remember the exact chapter numbers. But so there's a switched order there. 1 and 2 Chronicles is one of the better books preserved, but there are some important differences. In the Septuagint, sometimes there's some... Near the end of 2 Chronicles, there's a lot of extra stuff. But otherwise, it's mostly the same throughout. Ezra Nehemiah, that one, in its original version, was much longer. There was extra details and rearranged as well. And I don't know if you've heard of the book called First Esdras, but that's what I believe the original version was. The problem is the copies of First Esdras that we have are missing like half of the book. And it's going through the story of Ezra, and then it skips all the way near the end of Nehemiah, and then the ending is missing too. So First Esdras is the original version, but it's missing a bunch of stuff by the scribes. So there's that. Then there's Esther. In our version of Esther in the Hebrew text, there's no mention of God, no mention of Yah. You know, his name is not mentioned. Religion is not mentioned. The Torah, the Law of Moses, none of that's mentioned. It's a godless book. Secular writing, there's nothing really divinely inspired about it, really. In contrast, in the Septuagint version, you have the name of God mentioned 50, like over 50 times. You have the Law of Moses praised throughout the entirety of it, and there's like references to religion all throughout. It's like there's some amazing stuff in there. It like it completely changes the story, and to me, that is divinely inspired. The religious version, it's just very impressive to me, inspiring to me. So that's one of the biggest differences. Esther is hugely different. Let me just go through the other ones quickly. Job, as I said, the Septuagint version removes a lot of stuff, and it seems, based on my study, that the Septuagint is not correct in removing stuff. Sometimes the Septuagint has correct details that the Masoretic doesn't, and I do believe the Septuagint probably is translating it better than our scribes are translating the Masoretic text. But I think there's so many flaws with the Septuagint that what you really have to do is take the Septuagint, but then look at the Hebrew and really like follow the Hebrew when the Septuagint is messed up. For Job, Psalms, the Book of Psalms in the scrolls was found in a fuller version of the Book of Psalms, and I can tell you that for Psalms 1 to 89, they are mostly the same, some significant differences here and there, you know, but mostly the same. A couple of the Psalms are in a different order, but otherwise, it's basically Psalms 1 to 89 are pretty much the same. Psalms 90 to the end, however, in the original version of the scrolls that was found, is just completely different. It's the same Psalms, but in a very different order, and it has so many extra Psalms, too, and so many extra compositions. So, in ours, we have 150. In the one of the Dead Sea Scrolls, there's something like 12 to 15 extra Psalms in the Book of Psalms. So I'm very much convinced that's the original version of the Psalms. And there's Proverbs, Septuagint Proverbs, compared to the Hebrew, the Masoretic. There's like hundreds of extra Proverbs in the Septuagint version. And I'm inclined to agree with the Septuagint being the more authentic one, because here's why. In the Bible, we're told that Solomon did 3,000 Proverbs. He wrote 3,000 Proverbs. Well, when you count the Proverbs in the Book of Proverbs, we don't have 3,000 Proverbs. We have much fewer. So where are the extra Proverbs? Well, the Septuagint has some of those extra Proverbs, and I think that Septuagint is authentic in this. And so you look at through the Book of Proverbs, compare it. There's like so many extra Proverbs like everywhere on every page. And then some of the Proverbs are rearranged, like major rearrangements. Near the end of the book, chapters like 30 something around there is in chapter 25. It's like arranged differently. So that's Proverbs. Ecclesiastes is basically the same in the different versions, minor differences. And then Song of Solomon. In the Dead Sea Scrolls, it shows a different version of Song of Solomon. The words are mostly the same, but the order is very different in the Dead Sea Scroll version. The order of the Song of Solomon. So a different order. Then, let's see, Isaiah, mostly the same, some important differences. Jeremiah, again, the Septuagint is missing a lot of stuff, which I don't think is valid, that it's missing that. So I think the Hebrew is much more important in that sense of preserving lost passages, not in the Septuagint version. But the Septuagint presents chapters 44 or something around there to chapter 51, like something like that. It puts those chapters in the Septuagint version is in chapter 25. And I think that order is the correct, the original version. But so there's a different order of some of the prophecies of Jeremiah. Ezekiel is mostly the same. Lamentations mostly the same. Daniel is another one there's some major differences between the Septuagint and the Hebrew version. Extra passages. Chapters 4 to 6 have a lot of rearranged order. There's the song of the huge long song in the Book of Daniel. So there's some differences there between the two versions. And then the 12 Prophets is the final book, and the order of the 12 Prophets differs significantly in the different versions, Septuagint, Masoretic, and the Dead Sea Scrolls. So the order differs, and then in some books of the Minor Prophets, there's many differences. In others, there's very few, like the Book of Jonah, Obadiah, those are pretty well preserved, but in other ones, there's many more differences. So that's kind of an overview of the Old Testament. There's like people are not aware of this, but I've gone through and looked in depth, and I've marked most of these differences, and it's just mind-opening and shows you, wow, like, what have we lost? You know, there's so much, and as one of you said, as Lee said, beware of the lying pen of the scribe. That's what Jeremiah tells us, and that has definitely happened. The law, the prophets have been altered by the scribes and corrupting the truth. So some people think the New Testament is horribly corrupt because there's so many differences in some of the manuscripts. But in reality, the Old Testament is much worse than the New Testament. The New Testament is very well preserved in comparison. Let's see. It's pretty much it, but there was one other thing someone was asking, and that is, does 3 Corinthians exist anywhere outside of just the Armenian text? There's the Apocryphal book called 3 Corinthians. And yes, it does. There's Greek. It's in Greek. It's in Latin. And it is in Coptic, Egyptian. Okay, so it exists in those three. I accept 3 Corinthians as authentic in scripture. But yeah, you have to, there's all different kinds of manuscripts which have differences in all these different books. So it makes it complex to figure out the truth often. But that's part of a seeker of truth. That's what the seeker of truth has to do, is that they have to be open to the evidence. And they have to be willing to, you know, not take the easy way like so many Christians do and just say, oh, well, the Bible as we have it, that's perfectly preserved. You know, if he wanted to get his word to us, he could do it, and he would have done it, and he did. That's what they say. But unfortunately, the Bible tells us otherwise. The Bible tells us that the Book of Enoch is scripture, and yet it's not in the Bible. The Bible quotes from the Old Testament, and yet the quotations don't match, and there are major differences. They quote passages that are nowhere to be found. The Church Fathers quote passages nowhere in our copies. You know, the Church Fathers are quoting the Septuagint, not our version. So why do we, we came out of the Protestant group. So many of the Hebrew roots people came from the Protestants. Why do the Protestants follow their version when most of Christianity, at least in the early church, in the first few centuries, were following the Septuagint version? You know, so it's like people like to think that the Bible that they have is the true one, and they think it's impossible that the one we have could be unreliable. But in reality, when we look at the evidence with an unbiased mind, we see that our Bibles are corrupt. They're missing lots of scriptures, books of scriptures. They're missing many passages that should be in these books, and there's some errors and falsehoods inserted by the scribes. We have to be honest, and that's really what the evidence tells us. So it's a difficult task, and some people leave the faith because of this truth. They've seen it, and when they see it, they realize how horrible it is, and they become atheists. Well, just so you know, it's not logical to conclude that the scriptures are corrupt, therefore atheism. That's foolish. At best, you can conclude, okay, well, maybe the Bible's not true then. But to conclude atheism is ridiculous. I'm convinced that there is a God. We have to believe that. There's so much evidence for it. And whether or not the Bible's true is not going to change the basic principles of morality and righteousness. And it's not going to change the basic truths of our faith. It should not. Our faith should be based on nature and on the spirit of righteousness, and that I believe it agrees with the scriptures, but it also is superior to the scriptures, and we need to follow that first before we follow the scriptures. Because if we don't follow the spirit of righteousness first, then when we're interpreting scripture, we're going to be led astray by the falsehoods. And then, even when there's no falsehoods, we're going to interpret it in a way that is false, and we're going to lead ourselves astray, even when the text is pure. So that's the problem. You have to purify your heart, seek truly and purely, and then you will find the truth, you'll find his word, and you'll be set. It's a difficult task, but if you're willing to go through it with me, then we'll do this together, and we'll try to figure out what the scriptures are, and we'll try to follow it to the best we can. So that's it. That's the presentation. Thank you for coming, and I hope you attend next week. It'll be once a week. I'll try to do it once a week. So next Wednesday, the same time, 9 p.m. Eastern. Thank you all. Shalom.